scripture reading for today is found on page 244 in your Pew Bible, reading 2 Samuel chapter 6, beginning at verse 12 down to verse 23. So 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 12 to 23. Now King David was told, "The Lord has blessed the household of Obed-Edom and everything he has because of the Ark of God." So David went to bring up the Ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. When those who were carrying the Ark of the Lord had taken six steps, he sacrificed a bull and a fattened calf. Wearing a linen ephod, David was dancing before the Lord with all his might, while he and all Israel bringing up the Ark of the Lord with shouts and the sound of trumpets. As the Ark of the Lord was entering the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, watched from the window. And when she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. They brought the Ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent, and David had pitched for it. And David sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before the Lord. After he had finished sacrificing the burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord Almighty. Then he gave a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins to each person in the whole crowd of Israelites, both men and women. And all the people went to their homes. When David returned home to bless his household, Michal, daughter of Saul, came out to meet him and said, "How the king of Israel has distinguished himself today, going around half naked in full view of the slave girls of his servants, as any vulgar fellow would." David said to Michal, "It was before the Lord who chose me rather than your father or anyone from his house when he appointed me ruler over the Lord's people Israel. I will celebrate before the Lord. I'll become even more undignified than this, and I will be humiliated in my own eyes. But by these slave girls you spoke of, I will be held in honor." And Michal, daughter of Saul, had no children to the end of her death, to the day of her death. This is God's word for us this morning. I want to start the sermon with a little bit more music. I wasn't going to give you much warning, but I'll give you a little bit of warning. It might be a little loud. I'll try not to be too loud. Recognize the song?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
All right. Anybody remember who sang it?
Kenny Loggins.
Right. Now, I was going to apologize for playing that song. I thought about it, and then I realized it's a bit of a shock to hear Footloose on a Sunday morning, perhaps. But that was a bit of the point, really, wasn't it? The shock. Now, try to imagine the king of Israel with a garment basically wrapped around his waist and covering what was necessary, but that's about it. The ephod, the linen ephod they talk about, it's kind of debated what it was, but basically he was not wearing many clothes and dancing through the streets of Jerusalem, not long after he had been named king. I had a vision of Queen Elizabeth on her coronation day. I don't think we'll go there. We want to respect. But that's how shocking it would have been for the people, for them to hear this, right? And see this, their king, out in the street, celebrating in this way. And yet the story tells us that David was dancing before the Lord with all his might. This is repeated a couple of times. Before the Lord with all his might. It seems that in his own way, David was fulfilling the greatest commandment, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength. David is now the king of all Israel, and as leader, he feels like he is setting an example to the people of loving God with all his strength and celebrating all the great things that God had done for him and his people. So as you know, the series of sermons, three sermons, we're looking for lessons in leadership from David's life. And speaking of leaders, tomorrow night we have a deacon's meeting. But have no fear, we're not going to be starting dancing lessons, although that would be fun. But we don't want to make the meeting too long. Although, you know, Ruth, I was thinking, you know, the PBC bringers, PBC dancing dinger, dancing deacons. What do you think? That would be a major fundraiser? Where's Pam? She's good over that.
I will let the rest of them know.
So there are lessons in leadership in this story, and they help us to understand the power to praise. The power to praise our God. And we begin to understand this if we ask that question, why do we praise God? Why do we praise God? C.S. Lewis wrote a book on the Psalms and devoted a whole chapter that answers this question of why do we praise God? Lewis says that he had observed in life that all enjoyment spontaneously overflows into praise. All enjoyment spontaneously overflows into praise. And if we stop and think about that in our everyday life, how true it is. Sports fans, you're watching your favorite team play, and they win. Do you sit there and go, right? You're enjoying it. And then if they win this championship, chances are... That's all right. Jesus is our desire, right? So imagine you're watching your team win, all right? And then if they win the championship, like, chances are you're going to be dancing like David. Anything that we enjoy, we celebrate. Think of a music concert. You go and hear, you've been waiting to... I'm sorry to bring that up, because how many of us are missing just being out in music? But anyway. Think of going to a music concert, something you've been waiting to hear, and you just, after the concert, you just can't talk. Can't stop talking about that one song or how great they are. Let's go back to rug hooking, right? All of you who sit and enjoy doing crafts and working with your hands, like at the end of it, you just praise the person. Look at what they did. Those who prepare tasty food and desserts, same thing. Everything we enjoy, we praise. Every person who does something to give us joy, we praise them and we thank them. And it really is the same thing with God. We enjoy God. Therefore, we praise him. We enjoy a life with God and with God's people. So we celebrate and we praise. And this is what David is doing. He's enjoying God. He's celebrating the fact that God has blessed him. He has become a leader. To be a leader in the church of God, obviously we don't have to dance like David. There are other ways to experience the power to praise God. However, as a Christian who is an example to others, we want to show through our life that we enjoy our life with God. That we enjoy it, that God makes a difference in our life and gives us joy. In fact, if any of you are from a Reformed background, you know what the Westminster Shorter Catechism says, that the chief end of our relationship with God is we want to glorify God in our life and enjoy him forever. So when it comes to the power of praise and enjoying God, however, there are always people around us, sometimes in the church and otherwise, want to rob our joy. And this leads to our second question. Why do we judge the way other people praise God? Now, when I use the word judge, I mean it in the negative sense of criticizing, right? I don't mean it in the sense of having good judgment. For when we worship God, obviously we need judgment, we need wisdom when we think of how we want to worship God. For example, as you know, I've introduced a few different parts to the worship in our services. And even this on Friday when I sent out my pastoral letter, I shared a new tune to the Advent song of We Light the Advent Candles. Now, I did that ahead of time for you to sing it and look at it and say, oh, do I like this or do I want to sing the one in the hymn book? No problem either way. That's just showing good judgment. That's another type of judgment. What I'm talking about here is that kind of critical spirit that we know about, right? The judgment I'm talking about is just criticizing the way other people praise God. In the Bible story, David is center stage, dancing in the streets of Jerusalem, praising God. However, there's a heckler waiting in the wings. In verse 16, we are told that his wife, Michal, the daughter of King Saul, was watching David. And when she saw David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. And she goes on sarcastically in verse 20 and says, how the king of Israel has distinguished himself today, going around half naked like any vulgar fellow. Now, just a bit of history. Michal was given to David as a wife by her father, King Saul, when David had killed many of Israel's enemies. And at first she loved David very much, but now she ends up despising him. Her father was a very tall man, very big man, but he was also shy. And maybe she looked at David and thought of her own father as this kind of big, quiet, shy king, and said, you know, this is what kings do. But here's this David guy dancing in the street and going crazy. And she despised David for the emotions that he showed. She's like those two hecklers in the Muppet Show. Just never having anything good to say. And unfortunately, maybe we've run into people like that ourselves, and or have heard of these criticisms against other churches or other people and how they praise God. I remember one time I went with a friend to a charismatic Pentecostal church. I hadn't been a Christian real long, and we had gone to a pretty traditional church in the morning, and then he said in the afternoon, want to come to church with me tonight? And I knew he was a Pentecostal, and I said, okay, sure. This was in the mid-80s, and this church already had a full worship band there, and they were rocking the place when we already got in, and so I thought, okay, that's interesting. At one point in the service, the guitar and the piano just played a long chord and just sat on that chord. The next thing I knew, everybody started making up their own song. They were singing in tongues. And it was like this wall of sound of everybody just singing in their own words. And it lasted probably, I didn't time it obviously, but it felt like a good pop song, about 3 or 4 minutes. And it just went on. And at first I thought, whoa, I felt a little tense. And then I thought, I'm not going to judge. Let me just sit here quietly and pray and think about what I'm experiencing. And as we left the church, after the service, my friend said to me, this is where I come to enjoy my Christianity. Interesting enough, almost 20 years later, I'm in Mozambique, in Africa, and a very similar thing happens. Only in the pastoral prayer. One of my students at the Bible school, he was leading the pastoral prayer, and he began praying in his mother tongue, not Portuguese, which was the national language. Praying in his mother tongue. And then this wall of prayer started, and everybody's praying at the same time. And it rose like a crescendo. It just kept rising like a wave. And then without anybody saying anything, it just went down again until it was one voice. It was this amazing experience. And again, I just kind of sat quietly and thought, okay, this is not normal for me, but it is for them. And again, it was another experience of understanding how different people praise God in different ways. And when I think about coming to Perot and worshiping each Sunday, I hope that you can say with my friend at the Pentecostal church. This is where I come to enjoy my Christianity. And even if you don't know where you are on the road of Christianity, I hope you are able to come to enjoy the fellowship of God's people. It must be the case for many of you, obviously, because you keep coming back. However, there may be others who are not coming because they don't really enjoy church, or they have a stereotype of what a Baptist church is. And to be leaders in our church, we're going to ask ourselves if we are judging negatively the worship of others or the expectations of worship of others, particularly maybe younger people. And we're just going to ask ourselves, are we open? Are we open to praise God in ways that other people want to praise? The final question for today is this: how do we praise God with all of our being? How do we praise God with all of our being? Praising God and enjoying our life with God will look different for all of us here, depending on how we praise God, depending on how comfortable we are with showing our emotions, depending on our personality. And that's the marvel of the church, is that we're all different, and yet we all come together because we are united in the love of God. So how do we praise God with all of our being? But again, we're not all going to be dancing like David, but what David's dancing before the Lord does teach us about a leader and an example of enjoying God is that a leader celebrates being in the presence of God. A leader wants to be in the presence of God on a regular basis. So in this story, we see the Ark of the Lord, or the Ark of the Covenant. Again, made famous Indiana Jones' first movie, right? But the Ark, remember, it was just a wooden chest. Now, it was inlaid with gold, both inside and outside. But it was a wooden chest. And then there were two gold angels. And they were at either end of the chest, and their wings were hovering over and pointing towards the center, and they were looking towards the center. And God promised that he would meet Israel, the people of Israel, when he met with the priests, when they sent the priests. God would meet and reveal his presence to them in the middle of this ark. And so the ark in this story, in the Old Testament, is a symbol for the presence of God, that God is with his people. Now, earlier in this chapter, David had tried bringing the ark into Jerusalem. He had a huge military parade planned with 30,000 soldiers. But David made a mistake. He put the ark on a simple ox cart, and it hit a rut in the road. The ark was going to tip, and one of the men who was by the ark, or by the cart, touched it, and he was struck down dead. Well, that's one of those stories that you kind of scratch your head, right, when you read them. Why? And then for 3 months, David wouldn't go near the ark. He left it at the house of Obed-Edom outside of Jerusalem. And yet God revealed his presence and blessed that house. So after 3 months, David had learned his lesson and thought, maybe I just can't treat God just like any one of my soldiers. Maybe this is not about me and my military parade. Maybe this really is about the presence of God in my life, in his people's lives. And so he comes after 3 months with a different attitude. They don't put it on an ox cart, but they follow the scriptures and said four people will carry it on their shoulders. And they were priests. They had to be priests. And so he brings it in to Jerusalem, and they celebrate. They celebrate. And so David, like all of us, who are leaders in the church and examples in the church, he learns that the church is not about praising him or her or us. It is about praising and acknowledging the name of God with joyful and humble hearts. As leaders and Christians, as we seek to praise God with all our heart, we need to examine our motives for praising God. We are called to enjoy God, but not to just treat God like any other person. But we are thankful. We don't need an ark in our house. We have the Holy Spirit living in us. God is present with us. We're coming to Advent, Emmanuel, Jesus, God with us. So we don't need any special symbols, but Jesus is with us always. And so we simply want to make time to be with him to be in God's presence every day. And this may involve emotions. God wants our whole heart, our whole life. Our Father invites us to love Him, to be with Him, and to thank Him, and to depend on Him. And as we said in the responsive reading, God is our shepherd. We are the flock under His care. He invites us to be with Him. And Jesus also said, when we believe in Him, we can praise and worship God in spirit and in truth. So now, you may have figured out why I played Footloose at the start of the sermon. But let me explain at the end of the sermon, for those of you who may not know. In the movie Footloose, the town was controlled by a strict church that made dancing against the law. They actually passed a law against dancing. But when a newcomer comes into town, Kevin Bacon, he argues before the town council that dancing is a way that young people celebrate life. He then uses this very passage from 2 Samuel chapter 6 about David dancing before the Lord to convince the counselors and the local pastor. They listen to him and they admit they need to change. They vote to allow dancing back in town. Now, I'm thankful that this is a church that is not nearly as strict as that church in the movie. I'm thankful that you have put up with quite a few things already in 2 months. thank you for your grace and your goodness and your openness. So this message is really just a reminder to all of us to just examine these questions. Why do I praise God? I want to enjoy God and to renew our commitment to enjoy God. It's a reminder to not be critical. Yes, to have good judgment, to be wise, but not have a critical spirit. Be open. And then simply to take all that we have and give it to God so that we can follow Him. It's a reminder that as spiritual leaders in our community, we need to simply be an example of what it is to enjoy God to others around us. And as I close, let me repeat the words we heard earlier in our responsive reading. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Amen. Thank you. Let us go in peace to love and enjoy our Lord.